Welcome everybody to the continuation of our physics seminar series. Today we have an excellent speaker and a wonderful guest, Dr. Mercedes Pinencia, and she is from the University of Geneva. She actually comes from us from Rome, and she got her master's degree at the University of Rome. She then was at the University of Geneva for her PhD, which I could attest is a fantastic place. And it's something we share in common because I was also got my PhD from the University of Geneva. She's also done experiments and work at the OPERA experiment on neutrino oscillations at CERN. And she's been doing a very high impact study in the high, and that's the her presentation today is a high precision cosmic ray and space radiation measurements with the Alpha Magnet Spectrometer on the International Space Station and the development of the PAN instrument for deep space exploration. So please join me in welcoming her for this seminar today. All right.
Thank you. Yes, so I'm going straight away to the outline of my talk. I will briefly introduce charged cosmic rays, the energy spectrum and the composition, which is the main topic of the measurements of AMS, and then also for PAN, the effect of the solar activity on cosmic rays. Then I will talk about the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer, which is now operating on the International Space Station since almost 10 years. We'll describe the detector, what we have done for the construction of this detector, and our recent results on cosmic rays and near-Earth space radiation. Finally, I will flash some slides on the work we are doing on the development of a small magnetic spectrometer to measure radiation in space. So cosmic rays are particles mostly charged. We have also photon and neutrino, but they are less abundant. The bulk of cosmic rays are charged particles. Most of them are protons, about 90%. Then we have 9% of helium nuclei, and nuclei heavier than helium only account for about 1%. Electrons also are only 1% of the total flux. And positrons and antiprotons are really highly suppressed because they are mostly produced as secondary particles by interaction of primary cosmic rays within the stellar medium. Now, even though charged cosmic rays represent the bulk of the rotation, so they are interesting to study because this is what make most of the cosmic rays. Their study is made difficult because they don't point back to the sources because of galactic magnetic fields. But still, so the interpretation of the cosmic charged cosmic rays is made difficult because we have to disentangle the effect of propagation, so through the galaxy, spallation with interstellar medium, and also then the effect near Earth of the sun. So in cosmic rays, we found basically all particles. Most abundant, as I said, are protons. These plots show the comparison of cosmic ray abundance by the black points by Simpson. These are measurements done at 1 GeV per nucleon. And then the measurements are compared by measurement of the abundance in the solar system by the other symbol, the blue one. So what we see is that most abundant species are protons and helium, and then we have all the nuclei. And also we see some steps in the abundances after oxygen, and then another one after silicon, and then after iron. Elements heavier than iron are really much suppressed. And this is linked to the way nuclei are synthesized in stars. So very light elements were also produced at Big Bang during nucleosynthesis at Big Bang time. While elements below the iron are believed to be produced mostly in the nuclear fusion in the core of stars. But these elements heavier than iron, and then they need very high pressure to be produced, and they are thought to be produced mainly by supernova explosions. Then we also see an even and odd effect, which is the nuclear physics effects that tell us that even nuclei are more tightly bound. In addition, we have some species that are more abundant in cosmic rays than in the solar system, like the lithium, beryllium, boron group, fluorine, and the group from scandium to manganese, that are the so-called sub-iron elements group. These are indeed not abundant products of stellar nucleosynthesis, but in cosmic rays, we found lots of them because they are produced by collision of heavier primary with the interstellar medium. So this, the energy spectra of cosmic rays ranges from 100 MeV up to 10 to 20 electron volts, and the spectrum is a rapidly falling power law in energy, with the index that is about e to the minus 2.7. So this makes the drives the detection technique of cosmic rays. So for instance, at around 1 TeV, we have one particle per square meter per second. At the very high energies, we need a very big detectors because we have only one particle per square meter per year. This has driven the detection technique of cosmic rays, which use direct detection by balloons or spaceport detectors up to the TV. Nowadays, we are starting to have a larger calorimeter-based instrument, both on the space station and on satellites, that arrive up to 10 to the hundreds of TV. So AMS is measuring in the region between 1 GV and a few TV. And it has the capability, being a magnetic spectrometer, to measure charged the sign of the charged particle, so positive and negatively charged particle, and also because, as I will show now, because of instruments that are able to precise measure the beta, the velocity of the particles, we can also do isotopic composition. Large, so for the high end of the spectrum, we need large detectors and ground-based detectors, basically kilometer size, which employs a different technique, air Cherenkov and also air shower arrays. And nowadays, we have also other instruments that use radio, the detection of radio waves. So the advantage of the spaceborne detectors is the fact that they access the cosmic ray particles before they enter the atmosphere, so before they interact with the nucleizing atmosphere and produce showers. And so they don't have to rely on models of hadronic shower development to reconstruct the identity of the particle, or the cosmic ray particle. Then the spectra, as I said, this is the whole particle spectra, has a few spectral breaks at the knee, so 10 to the 15 electron volt, and the ankle at much higher energy beyond 10 to the 18 electron volt. Because of the detection accuracy of particles from the GV up to the TV range, it was believed that below the knee, the flux was described by a simple power law that goes like the energy at the minus 2.7. But nowadays, with the deployment of precise detector of Pamela first inaugurated the precision era of cosmic rays, and IMS took the legacy and extending the measure, the precision measurement up to the TV. We are now seeing that there exist also spectral fissures below the knee, as I will discuss later. And the name of these fissures resembles the shape of a human leg, that's why. Often you will see the spectrum multiplied by the energy or rigidity at 2.6. This is usually done to put in evidence the structure of the spectrum. The spectrum on top of the e to the minus 2.7 behavior. In addition, low energy cosmic rays up to the 30 GV or so are affected by the sun by the sun magnetic field. So the sun emanates its magnetic fields in the nearby space, in the what is called the heliosphere, which forms a sort of bubble, which is able to screen galactic cosmic rays, and so low energy galactic cosmic rays will be modulated and the intensity reduced depending on the size and the strength of the heliosphere, which is variable in time. So here below you see the interplanetary magnetic field, which is the emanation of the sun magnetic field in the heliosphere. And you see that the intensity varies with time. Here are the years, and it has a cycle that is roughly 11 years. AMS has now started data taking in 2011, and now we are almost reaching a complete solar cycle. Now, the question we are trying to understand, studying cosmic rays, is to understand their origin, from where they come from, how they get accelerated to these high energies, which are the transport mechanisms from their source to us, and whether there are exotic sources of cosmic rays like dark matter signals. And the observables we have are spectral features, mass composition, so the individual spectral cosmic rays, comparing secondary and primary cosmic rays, measuring the isotopic composition of nuclei, will give us a lot of information. And in addition, also measuring the arrival direction, whether the flux is isotropic or not. Plus, in addition to the study of charged cosmic rays, important ingredient approach nowadays is the multi-messenger approach, so the counterpart in X-rays, gamma rays, and neutrinos. So we think that the bulk of cosmic rays below the NEO, what is called the second NEO, is of galactic origin. This is based on energetic calculation, which I'm not discussing here in details. But so let's go now to the kind of particles we are measuring with AMS. So we have a primary cosmic rays particle that comes from the sources of cosmic rays. These are electrons, protons, and most of the nuclei, helium, carbon, oxygen, iron, silicon. Some of the nuclei, as I mentioned before, are of secondary origin, means that they are produced by collision of primary cosmic rays with interstellar medium. And among these, we found not only some nuclei, as I mentioned before, lithium, beryllium, boron, fluorine, and the sub-iron elements, but also positrons, antiprotons are thought to be mostly secondary. That's why their abundance is so suppressed compared to protons. And that's why we see in the spectrum of positrons and antiprotons that we're looking for tiny signal that could arise by the annihilation of decay or hypothetical dark matter particles in pairs of positrons and electrons, or protons and antiprotons. Positrons and electrons can also be produced by other astrophysical sources as pulsars. In addition, some traces of residual antimatter produced at the Big Bang could be still around, and one of the research items of EMS will be to detect anti-nuclei. And we can also detect exotic form of matters like strangelings. In addition, particles are also produced from the sun as a coronal mass ejection during eruption from the solar corona. So this is the EMS detector. We basically miniaturize a detector that is usually used at the accelerators, and we adapted to operate it in the space. The heart of the detector is a magnetic spectrometer made by a silicon tracker. We have seven layers inside the magnet core. The magnet is a permanent magnet. Then we measure the energy, the momentum of the particle by the bending of the track inside the magnet. And the particle absolute charge is measured by the energy deposition inside the silicon. On the top and the bottom of the magnet, there are two double layers of time of flight, scintillators, which measure again the charge and the beta of the particles. The transition radiation detector is placed on the top of the upper top, to disentangle light particles or leptons from hadrons. So this is very important for the identification of positrons to remove the protons background, and similarly for the antiprotons, to disentangle antiprotons from electrons. In addition, on the bottom, we have a ring imaging Cherenkov, which measures the charge and the beta of the particles. The beta here is measured with a per mil precision. This is one of the key detectors together with the TOF that allow us to do isotopic composition. And finally, we have an electromagnetic calorimeter to measure the energy of positrons and electrons with a precision of a few percent. On the very top and the bottom of the apparatus, we have two additional tracker layers, layer 1 and layer 9, to extend the lever arm to 3 meters. And this allows us to reach a maximum detector rigidity. Rigidity is the momentum divided the charge of the particle. So we can reach a rigidity of 3 terabytes. The MS detector was built by an international collaboration, which is led by the US Department of Energy. In Geneva, we had the task of assembling and building the silicon tracker together with the INFN Perugia in Italy. So here are some pictures from 2007 when we assembled the inner tracker. Here you can see the cables running from the silicon layers. The inner tracker is inserted in this kind of structure to be transported at CERN and assembled with the rest of the detectors. And this is the assembly of the layer 9. We then integrated the detector at CERN. We did an extensive campaign to calibrate the detector with test beam at CERN with different particles of different energies. And finally, in May 2011, the detector was launched on the space shuttle Endeavour, and it was installed on the International Space Station. We started to take data soon after. And we will continue to operate MS for the entire lifetime of the ISS. So MS is a quite a big detector to be in space. The size is about 5 meters by 3 meters by 4, and the weight is 7.5 tons. The data is transmitted on ground to the tracking data relay satellite system. Then it goes to the NASA New White Sands facility, to Marshall, and from Marshall to the MS Payload Operation Control Center at CERN in Geneva. And to command the detector is on computer where which automatically run the detector. In case we have to send commands, the commands goes the other way around. In addition, we have a laptop. This allow us to also send command the MS detector through the laptop. In case there is a need of intervention, astronaut can take over. So far, we have collected 170 billion cosmic rays events, and we expect to have to double the statistics in 2030. We have published the results on positrons, electrons, and nuclei from proton now up to silicon, and lately also iron. We have also published the isotopic composition measurements of helium nuclei and detailed fluxes as function of time for electrons and positrons, for proton and helium. And we have in preparation study on nuclei, carbon and boron. We have recently summarized the results of EMS from the first 7 years of operation in a physics report paper that has appeared in last September. So I'm discussing now the main results on cosmic positrons and electrons. On the left, you see the experimental status before the advent of the EMS. So an excess on the positron flux was observed. But with EMS, this is the picture on the right, we had fully characterized the spectrum of electrons and positrons, showing that they have the totally distinct behavior. And so to really study in details electrons and positrons, you need a magnetic spectrometer. Concerning the flux of electrons, traditionally it was assumed that the flux would be a power law with a spectral index minus 3, so power law like energy to the minus 3. But with our recent data, we have put in evidence that about 42 GeV, the electron spectrum shows significant excess over the e to the minus 3 behavior, which has a 7-sigma significance. So this is one of the spectral features that appears below the so-called Ni. The positron spectrum is expected if it was completely from secondary origin, according to what is known, according to the current models, the secondary positron should have a spectrum that decay with increasing energy, like the depicted by the green shaded area. But we clearly see that there is an excess on top of this green area at high energy. So this could be either a new source or the calculation of the secondary production of positrons is not correct. There are other factors to be taken into account. In addition to the MS, we have characterized the shape of this source term, which show to have an exponential cutoff at around 800 GeV. So from where these positrons can possibly come from? They can come from, as I explained before, it can come from astrophysical sources like pulsar, the collision of primary cosmic rays with interstellar medium, but also from the dark matter, from the dark matter annihilation or decay. So how can we distinguish all these sources? Well, positron from pulsar should exhibit a higher anisotropy in the arrival direction, because we know that dark matter is roughly homogeneously distributed. In addition, pulsar do not produce antiprotons. So looking at the arrival direction of positrons and looking at the antiproton spectrum, we can understand something more on the origin of positrons. So we have studied the arrival direction of positrons in the of energies ranging from 16 GeV to 500 GeV. On the left is the sky map of the arrival direction of such protons in galactic coordinates. On the right is a sky map in the hypothesis of isotropic positron flux. And we have found no deviation from isotropy. So we have put a limit on the dipole anisotropy of the positron flux. What about the antiproton? This is the IMS antiproton flux, and the interpretation of this antiproton flux at high energy still suffers from uncertainty in the modeling, mainly arising from the pure knowledge that we have on spallation cross-section, nuclear cross-section. But what is interesting is if we compare the shape of the antiproton flux in blue with the shape of the positron, we found that at high energy, they are quite similar. If you take the ratio, this is flat. And this has brought some speculation on the fact that maybe there are the calculation of the secondary production is wrong. And the good news is that we can constrain cosmic ray models studying cosmic ray nuclei. In particular, if we compare primaries with secondaries. So primary cosmic rays, as I said before, are produced by nuclear fusion. Then at the end of the stars, they are expelled and accelerated in a supernova explosion. These are the way iron is expelled mostly. Other nuclei can come also, can be already synthesized before the stars die. And among the primary cosmic rays, we found protons, helium, silicon, carbon, oxygen, and iron. And again, we know this by comparing with the solar system abundance. So this is the MS measurement in red of the protons compared to other detectors. As you can see, the energy range where EMS is sensitive is still the most accurate experiment. So if we look at the spectrum of protons multiplied by the rigidity 2.7, we found that it has a clearly deviation from a simple power law. Similar observation is done for the helium flux, here shown in red for EMS compared to other detectors. And on the right, the MS results that show a clear deviation from a simple power law with a break that is around 300 GV, similar to protons. We have also measured helium, carbon, and oxygen and found that the spectral shape of helium, carbon, and oxygen is identical above 60 GV, and all three have exhibited spectral hardening. So now, which is the origin of the spectral hardening? And the other question that we have is also whether the spectral hardening is the same for all nuclei. So to understand the origin of the spectral hardening is interesting to look at secondaries, because secondaries that are produced by interaction of these primaries with the interstellar medium. So among the secondary, we find the lithium, beryllium, and boron, fluorine, but also the sub-iron elements. So this secondary brings the information of what happened, cosmic rays, while they propagate through the galaxy. So lithium, beryllium, and boron are merely produced by carbon and oxygen, while fluorine is mainly comes from neon, magnesium, and silicon. And the sub-iron elements mainly come from iron. So cosmic rays are propagates through the interstellar medium, which is a turbulent magnetized medium. And so they propagate by diffusively. There are several diffusion models, but all predict that the secondary to primary ratio is asymptotically proportional to the rigidity to the minus delta, and delta brings the information on the propagation. Now, the interpretation of the spectral hardening falls in three categories. The first one that explains the spectral break observed as injected already by the sources. During propagation, the spectra gets additional factor delta due to the propagation effect. Then the secondary cosmic rays, which are the results of the primary cosmic rays interacting with the stellar medium, has a similar spectral break as the primaries. And so at Earth, what we will observe is a secondary to primary ratio, which is featureless. Another class of interpretation says that the primary cosmic ray spectrum injected by the source is a featureless power law, R to the minus gamma. At propagation, there is the spectral break is due to the propagation effect. And in this case, a secondary cosmic ray should experience twice the spectral break of primaries. And when we observe the ratio of secondary to primary at Earth, what we will see is a spectral hardening. A third category of interpretation says that the spectral break is due to a local source that injects locally additional primary cosmic rays. But the bulk of the spectrum from distant sources is a featureless spectra. This implies that the spectra of secondaries has no feature. And then that the secondary to primary ratio will have a softening. So that's why the measurement of secondary to primary ratio is important to understand the origin of the spectral breaks that have been observed. We have measured then lithium, beryllium, and boron with EMS. And in some cases, the measurements were really lacking, like for the case of lithium and beryllium, the very large errors. With EMS, we have improved the experimental situation, and we have also observed that also the secondary cosmic rays, lithium, beryllium, and boron, exhibit spectral hardening. But the spectral shape is distinctly different from the spectral shape of primaries. And if we take the ratio of the secondary cosmic rays, lithium, beryllium, and boron to oxygen, to these which is mostly primary, we observe a spectral hardening. So here the flux is multiplied by rigidity to 0.3. This 0.3 is about this value r to the minus delta that is comes from the propagation. So what we observed is then an hardening with a significance of more than 5 sigmas. And this favors the hypothesis that the observed spectral hardening is due to a propagation effect. Now, what about nuclei ever than oxygen? Do they also have hardening? Is the hardening the same size? We have recently published the spectra of neon, magnesium, and silicon. In this species, silicon is mostly primary. Neon and magnesium are mixed, but for the majority are primaries, and the high energy are mostly primary. If we compare then these fluxes among themselves, we have found that neon magnesium have a similar spectral shape, identical basically above a few GB, while silicon and magnesium are identical only starting from a higher energy. Then if we look at the spectral index, we found that all harden above 200 GB. And they harden the same way. Now, to see whether this spectral hardening has the same size as what we have observed for light or primary cosmic rays, we compared neon magnesium and oxygen neon magnesium and silicon to the oxygen. And we found that actually there is a softening. And so the significance of our observation exceeds once again 5 sigma. And we found then that we can distinguish in primary cosmic rays two classes of energy dependence, that of light, primary silicon, carbon, and oxygen, and the dependence of heavy primary cosmic rays, neon, magnesium, and silicon. And what about even heavier primaries? So we have recently published the results for iron. Again, on the left, AMS measurement in red compared to previous experiments, and on the right, our main results, which is the fact that the iron spectrum exhibits a spectral shape which is similar to the light, helium, carbon, and oxygen, primary cosmic rays. This is somehow unexpected, because one was expecting a sort of scaling. Then we have investigated also heavy secondary cosmic rays, so fluorine nuclei, and this is the paper that has just been published. As you see, previous measurements were really large error bars, and this is because fluorine are really rare in cosmic rays. What we have found is that above 175 GV, fluorine and boron have the same rigidity dependence, but globally, the rigidity dependence is quite different. And if we investigate the secondary to primary boron to oxygen or boron to carbon, and we compare to the heavy secondary to primary ratio fluorine to silicon, so you see here in red the ratio fluorine to silicon, and in blue the ratio boron to oxygen, we found that the rigidity dependence is really different. They all have a hardening, but the size of the hardening is different. And this is more visible if we take the ratio of fluorine to silicon to boron to oxygen. And we found that it is not, is 7 sigma away from zero, the spectral index. So this may be an hint that there are something happening in the propagation, or maybe in the sources of these heavy primary cosmic rays. Now let's go to lower energy and see what are the effects of solar modulation of cosmic rays. So as I said, mentioned before, the solar system, the sun creates around the solar system, the heliosphere, which screens the low energy particles. And this can be seen if we compare the measurement by AMS to the measurement done by Voyager, which is now have crossed the Helios heat and is in the interstellar medium. As you can see, the flux measured inside the heliosphere is suppressed. This is the effect of the solar magnetic field. If we take the proton to helium ratio, we find that the measurement outside the heliosphere from Voyager are nicely connected to the measurement inside the heliosphere taken by EMS, and that we have the gap. I will talk about this experimental gap later on. Now, the Sun has a cycle that, as I said, 11 years, which is the activity of the Sun, which is shown by the sunspot number. The more active, the more sunspot we see, as depicted in this plot here, where in blue are shown the sunspot number. And the more active and the higher will be the interplanetary magnetic field. And so the cosmic rays of low energy will be suppressed, so they will suffer more screening effect, as seen by neutron monitors that measure the bulk of cosmic rays at around 10 GeV, but also more precisely by space detectors like BESS in the past, so in PAMELA, and since 2011 by PAMELA, where we have characterized the fluxes of protons, electrons, and positrons as function of, and helium as function of time. In addition, the solar magnetic field has a further feature, which is a polarity reversal every at each solar maximum. So here is a picture that delineates, for instance, this is a situation at 2010 with the field lines going in this direction. Then around the solar maximum, the field lines start to rearrange until the next solar minimum, where the field lines have inverted polarity. And this generates charge assigned dependent effects on the solar modulation of cosmic rays. So with EMS, we have already published the monthly fluxes for proton and helium, and we have now we are preparing a paper on daily proton and helium. As you can see, we are almost measuring an entire solar cycle, and the different colors give you the different energy. So low energy particles are more affected by solar modulation, while high energy particles are less affected. And at about 30-50 GeV, the effect is negligible. Most importantly, if one studies particles of opposite charge, like electrons and positrons, this is our measurements of 27-day fluxes, we see that they exhibit differences. And this is related to the polarity of the sun magnetic field. In period of negative polarity, this is the ratio of positrons to electrons, so positrons are more suppressed. As we go through the period where the sun magnetic field line starts to arrange, the positron ratio start to increase and reaches a plateau when the field lines have inverted. We are now also investigating daily electron fluxes, and this will give us more insights in this phenomena. But now let's talk about this gap that we observe here. This is due to the fact that detectors that are measuring space radiation at low energy employs a technique which is the so-called range technique. So basically they stop the particle inside the material and then they measure the energy by measuring the range. But how can we fill this gap? Because this kind of technique of the range cannot measure particles above 100 MeV. We need a small magnetic spectrometer, and this is the project we are developing now in a consortium led by Professor Xin Wu in Geneva, the partners at Italy, Perugia, and at Prague. So we are proposing a small size magnetic spectrometer. So this is what is called PAN, for penetrating particle analyzer. The idea is to employ it for deep space exploration. So we try to keep it very small. The, this is like the shape is like a cylinder. Yes, four sectors of magnets, permanent magnets. The aperture of each magnet is 10 centimeters, and each sector is long 10 centimeters. Then at the entrance, there will be time of flight and pixel detector to sustain high rates during solar events. And at each end of the magnet sectors, there will be silicon strip detectors or microstrip detectors, a similar technique that we are using with EMS. And this will allow us to measure particles, penetrating particle, from 100 MeV up to the GeV region. So we have obtained a grant from the European Commission to build a demonstrator, which is called MiniPAN because it's smaller than PAN. The size of the demonstrator will be 20 centimeters times 30 times 20, so really portable with a smaller power size and reduced power consumption and reduced weight. The aim is to have less than 10 kilos. We have found to develop the demonstrator as a technological demonstrator for 3 years. The first year, which is now just passed, was for the design and mechanical electrical model development. We are now working on the final module development, and the third year we'll develop the system, assemble the demonstrators, and verify the performances. This is MiniPAN, so it's a smaller size, 5 centimeter aperture on the bore of the magnet. The length of each sector is 5 centimeter. We have only 2 sectors instead of 4. And to achieve a similar performance than PAN, we have increased the magnetic field to 0.4 Tesla. The magnet that we'll employ is a permanent magnet. And the idea is to have particle centers from both ends, from left or right, and to have acceptance to reconstruct particles that passes only one sector or also both sectors. So we have now doing the tests on the magnets. We have prototypes. The real magnets have been ordered and should arrive at CERN in 1 month or so. This is a magnet prototype, so it's ALBAC permanent magnets. We will have 2 of them, and these are the 2 magnets on the support system at CERN to measure and map the magnetic field. The tracker sensor will be silicon microstrip sensor. The challenge here is to have very thin sensor, so to reduce the material scattering. So usually in EMS and other detectors that we have developed, the thickness is 300 microns. Here we are aiming at half of the thickness, and with a reduced pitch of 25 microns. And then in addition, we are developing the readout of the electronics. A pixel detector will be placed at each end. This will need to be to sustain high rates during solar energetic particle events. The challenge for the pixel, which use the TimePix3 technology, is to reduce the power, to have it working at a reduced power consumption. We have done already some preliminary test beam at CERN. And finally, we have also TOF scintillators that will be read by silicon photomultiplier. Yeah, the work is being doing to develop the front-end electronics to meet the requirements of 100 picosecond time resolution. And in addition, so the idea, the physics of this detector will be mainly to space weather, solar physics, exploration of deep space radiation, and we are actively looking for flight opportunities from 2023 when the demonstrator at least will be concluded. And this brings me to my conclusion. So you have now in 9 years of the EMS operation on the ISS, we have collected more than 170 billion cosmic rays. And the accuracy, and we have published accurate data of nuclei and particles up to the TV, and for nuclei, we have measured all nuclei from protons up to silicon. We have indeed, I didn't show, but we have just submitted a paper on aluminum and sodium nuclei. And we have also published the iron nuclei. We are now investigating the nuclei in between silicon and iron. We run AMS for the entire lifetime of the International Space Station because it's a unique experiment. It's the only large magnetic spectrometer operating in space now, and we expect new and exciting discoveries. So as a legacy of AMS, we are now developing a small magnetic spectrometer to detect space radiation in deep space emissions. And this ends my presentation.
All right, thank you very much. Well, there's time for questions and discussions, so people could raise their hand or speak up as they wish. Let's see, or you could put the question in the chat and I'll read it off. It depends if you have a working microphone or not. Anyone want to go first? Okay, well, maybe I'll ask a few questions just to get started here. When AMS was talking about they were seeing some difference between matter and antimatter, that was the electron signal and positron signal in the early days?
I don't quite understand to what you are referring to.
I recall that there was some discussion that they were seeing some differences between matter and antimatter in their AMS detector.
Mm-hmm. So
I haven't heard much about it since.
Electrons are expected anyhow to be different from positrons because electrons are mainly primaries. Yeah. So now what is the unexpected observation is the fact that antiprotons are similar to positrons. Positrons are expected to lose energy faster than protons and than antiprotons. So the fact that the spectra is so similar at high energies is quite a puzzle. Then concerning matter and antimatter, we are also investigating anti-helium. I don't know whether you were referring also to that. For anti-helium, we have a handful of candidates. And I talk about candidates because it's very difficult. We didn't investigate in detail, and it's very difficult to see whether this could be a detector effect. Because we have no way to invert the magnet polarity, let's say. Yeah? So with the signal that is 1/10⁻⁹, it's really difficult to say whether this could be a detector effect. For the moment, we are not investigating further on this. We have a few candidates. And from the first checks, they seem so genuine. But this will require really a more detailed studies that we will do probably towards the end of the mission.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Other questions from other people?
So, hello, Hörermeier here. I wonder if you can comment about the usefulness of having AMS mounted on the space station. Have there ever been any servicing being done by the ISS crew or any other significant advantages compared to, just having a standalone satellite?
IMS is a quite a big, huge detector, much bigger, it's not so compact. So I think that after the Columbia disaster in 2003, AMS was not anymore in the the flight schedule of the NASA. So some other possibility were investigated, but was actually not possible to launch it as a separate satellite. Also because of the power consumption, it was not designed to work like that. Yeah. And then the advantage is that you can have astronauts to repair your cooling system. As we had 1 year ago.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so do you think it justifies the, complexity? I mean, a space station is, you know, always looking for justification, right? And it's, much easier to send robots into space than people. And so I wonder what your perspective is on how is the money best spent, I guess?
Mm-hmm. But for the operation of IMS, we don't really rely on astronauts. It's very rare the case where we had needed some intervention, and often we need because of some activity that is done on the ISS itself. The detector can be commanded from ground, and also in case the onboard computer, those that are really on the detector, are not working, we can operate it from the laptop. I think also that the ISS operation is kept also for understanding human exploration, because they, as a test bench, yeah. So really AMS is not the reason why they are running the ISS. So. In addition, there are also other experiments in the last days doing cosmic rays on the space station, like CALET on the JAXA segment and ISS screen. Yeah. And also there are many other experiments running on the space station that are more related to the study of the space environment. Really, for us, the investment was the launch to the station. Then the detector was built by the international collaboration. The operation are paid through common funds by every participating institute.
Right. Well, of course, if an experiment is on the ground, we tend to go to it and tinker around all the time. And of course, the Hubble repair is a spectacular example of how, we've done that successfully in space, but it just becomes much more complicated. So I was just, that's why I was wondering about your experience with AMS.
Okay, other questions from anybody?
I have a question. Can you hear me?
Go ahead, Richard.
One thing that caught my eye is that from a safety perspective, is there any comparison between for human flight, maybe interplanetary or beyond, between the safety considerations of, say, like ionizing radiation from the sun versus cosmic rays? I imagine there's probably a energy to flux comparison between the two, and I just never heard which one is more important from a safety perspective.
Mm-mm. Yeah, indeed, the importance of galactic cosmic rays is in the last years has been revised because they are very heavy nuclei. So even though the flux is not so high as those of protons or solar energetic particles, which are mostly protons and heliums, but the heavy nuclei can make a lot more damage in the human body. And so this has been revised, and actually NASA is using MS results to do the calculation of the estimation of hazard for human flight. And this is also somehow the importance also of the studies we are doing on daily and monthly fluxes, because we will have some information on the variability of the fluxes.
Well, how does it feel like to be on a International Space Station project doing particle physics? NASA quite often has a few cross-disciplinary fields, like the Fermi telescope is essentially a particle physics experiment. AMS is, but NASA is mostly concentrated in astronomy, astrophysics.
Yeah, indeed, AMS is not a NASA experiment, it must be stressed. It's a DOE-led experiment and with a strong contribution from international institution, international collaboration, yeah. But we have also strong support for the operation by a group at the NASA Johnson Space Center.
Okay. All right, any other questions? Or we'll call it the quits here. It was perfect timing. You did exactly perfect, the 50 minute talk and questions and answers. We have this course, this class, this seminar is part of a class, of course, here, as well as other people are invited to come to it. But sometimes when it's part of a class, the students have to run away exactly after an hour because they have another class.
Oh, I see.
All righty, well, if not, let's thank our speaker again. And thank you very much for your time and effort to give us a great seminar. Thank you.
Thank you for the invitation. It was my pleasure.
Okay.